Savitri notes and comments. A soul made ready. Ashwapati, the divine yogi, conceived and prepared the birth of Savitri. He conceived and prepared the birth of Savitri. The birth of Savitri in the mortal world. He did it occult yogically. First, in his own luminous spiritual womb, he came as a protagonist and compelled her birth, her mortal birth. There is an issue. Issue of this mortal world. This might be the God's world. This mortal world might be the God's world. But in it are present fate and ignorance and falsehood and suffering and pain and death. These having mighty sway over events and things. All this must go. All this must disappear. Must go. And a happy, growing, rich, prosperous life in the splendor of the spirit be founded. Happy, growing, rich, prosperous life in the splendor of the spirit be founded. That is the debt God has to pay. God has to pay to earth and men. Ashwapati comes in that context. Deeply in the setting of the mortal world, there has to be life in the life divine. There has to be life in the divine. And he takes every measure that it does happen, that it is accomplished. The strength of original permanence is there in him. A power from the unknowable working in him. That power must become operative in the mortal world. That operative power in the mortal world is Savitri. She will do whatever is to be done in the will of the Supreme. She will do whatever is to be done in the will of the Supreme. To bring her here is Ashwapati's yogic commitment. Thus indeed, Ashwapati is scripting the story of Savitri. He is his author of this story of Savitri, of the book named Savitri. Savitri, authored by him. That book is already written and it is kept in the archives of the unknowable. It details out the Savitri project. The project simply named Savitri. By doing intense yoga tapasya in this creation, he accesses the archival documents. Now, these in his hands, he follows the deep secrets that are locked in them. And what does he see in these archival documents? He sees prospects of human dreams. He sees prospects of superhuman dreams. The dream of the dreams. The dream of those dreams is life here on earth must become life divine. He sees prospects of superhuman dreams. The dream of those dreams is life here on earth must become life divine. To justify and realize those dreams, he comes as eternity delegate and compense divine Savitri's mortal birth. He compense divine Savitri's mortal birth. He is the emanation straight from the Supreme. Emanation straight from the Supreme. And he is committed to it. Committed to bring down Savitri in the mortal world. But this emanation straight from the Supreme, he, the protagonist, he, eternity's delegate, his spirit stooping from larger spheres, it looks in a hurried look, he to be an involutionary being, Ashwapati, an involutionary being. To a hurried look, he seems to be an involutionary being. He, not springing from the native soil of mortality, he, not an evolutionary being, not one who has come up in the process of toiling evolution, is Ashwapati, an involutionary being, not one who has climbed up the ladder of evolution. Does he have a psychic being? Does he have an evolving soul? But he has. He is the strength coming from the original permanence. The strength ever doing the work in the moment and in this flow. In it, the entire burden of mortality has to be accepted. When Ashwapati steps in time's process, his days become a long march of growth. A skyward being nourishing its road of sustenance from occult spiritual found, climb through white rays to meet an unseen sun. His soul lived as eternity's delegate. His mind was like a fire assailing heaven. His will a hunter in trails of light. His soul lived as eternity's delegate. His mind was like a fire assailing heaven. His will a hunter in the trails of light. A spirit that is a flame of God abides immortal in our mortal poverty. Take this line. His soul lives as eternity's delegate. Let us first scan it. His soul lives as Trochi, Ether, Nitis, Pyrrhic, delegate, dactyl. Metrically, a simple line. Trochi, Pyrrhic, dactyl. The dactyl delivering eternity. The last foot as an apist, Pyrrhic, would sound pretty weak. But significantly, the sense of the line is loaded with massively deeper and richer occult spiritual matters. Massively loaded with deeper and richer occult spiritual matters. The nature and process of avatarhood, that is, of incarnation, how the absolute being takes a human birth, how he comes as eternity's delegate. There seems to be some unrevealed secret in it, something not made explicit, or perhaps we missed that something in our hurried reading of the line. It could mean his soul came as eternity's delegate and lived the soul. His soul came as eternity's delegate and lived the soul. It could mean too, his soul became eternity's delegate and lived soul. His soul came as eternity's delegate and lived soul. His soul became eternity's delegate and lived soul. His soul came as eternity's delegate. His soul became eternity's delegate. The implication is, his soul came, had a strong sense of he being an involutionary being. In contrast to, his soul became as a progressive evolutionary one, making progress on its ladder of evolutionary ascension. Ashwapati is described as a protagonist, as a thinker and toiler, his spirit stooping down from larger spheres. He, a colonist, a pointing beam on Earth's road, he is a greater sonship. He, consenting to mortal ignorance, yet his knowledge sharing the ineffable light. A power is in him from the unknowable, a treasurer of superhuman dreams, an archivist, his soul as eternity's delegate. He is also described as a son of force, a son of strength, a strong forerunner, a seer, a shining guest in time. He pursues himself through forms, starting with fish, matsya, to man, the mental being, making him an evolutionary avatar. We should make a crucial distinction between his soul as eternity's delegate and his soul and eternity's delegate, as eternity's delegate and eternity's delegate. Ashwapati would be an involutionary being with an eternity's delegate, in contrast to the evolutionary in as eternity's delegate. It is in as that the descent makes Ashwapati eternity's delegate, one carrying evolution through the ages. But how does he become eternity's delegate? He becomes so by his yoga maya. He becomes eternity's delegate by his yoga maya. Establishing himself in his own nature, in his own prakriti, he becomes so by his own yoga maya. The Supreme comes down by electing a human vessel, a human soul, matured through ages to hold his charge. In the circumstance, when gloom leads to worse gloom, death to emptier death, the will to be becomes the original sin. That sin of the will to be is accepted, the Supreme and man being bound together. For that to be, the Supreme comes down by electing a human vessel. In the unfolding process of the cell, sometimes the inexpressible mystery elects a human vessel of descent. A breath comes down from supernal air. A presence is born. A guiding light awakes. Or a revealing force is blazing in. A greater personality sometime. And the unfolding process of the self. Sometimes the inexpressible mystery elects a human vessel of descent. But how does that happen? Rare is a cup fit for love's nectar wine, as rare as a vessel that can hold God's birth. A soul made ready through 1,000 years. Is the living mold of a supreme descent. That should settle the matter. It is a soul in human birth who through 1,000 years is made ready for a supreme descent. That is Ashwapati, who is not yet ready, who is going through human birth as vibhutis, as someone special, is going to be ready, to be Ashwapati, holding in him the divine or the supreme descent. But how does the immortal enter into this mortal poverty? That one who is involutionary, how does he step into evolution? By what occult mechanism? By what process? It happens by his own yoga maya. He lets himself go into the creation through her. He is a portion, a bit of a wonderful Mamai Aunsha, a flame of God, immortal, immortal. He is seated within. He is the spirit, accepting the conditions of nature. But what is the manner by which these conditions of nature are accepted? What is the process of avatarhood, the divine assuming a physical body? About this yoga maya, in the process of avatarhood, the best is to make a good effort to grasp what Srivindu has revealed in his writings from the essays of the Gita. The question then arises, and it is the sole real difficulty, for here the intellect falters and stumbles over its own limits. How is this human mind and body assumed? For they were not created suddenly and all of a piece, but by some kind of evolution, physical or spiritual, or both. No doubt, the descent of the avatar, like the divine birth from the other side, is essentially a spiritual phenomenon, as is shown by the Gita, Atmanam Srijami. It is a soul birth. But still, there is here an attendant physical birth. How then were this human mind and body of the avatar created? How were then this human mind and body of the avatar were created? If we suppose that the body is always created by the hereditary evolution, by inconscient nature and its immanent life spirit, without the intervention of the individual soul, the matter becomes simple. A physical and mental body is prepared fit for the divine incarnation by a pure or great heredity, and the descending Godhead takes possession of it. But the Gita in this very passage applies the doctrine of reincarnation boldly enough to the avatar himself. And in the usual theory of reincarnation, the reincarnating soul, by its past spiritual and psychological evolution, itself determines and in a way prepares its own mental and physical body. The soul prepares its own body. The body is not prepared for it without any reference to the soul. Are we then to suppose an eternal or continual avatar himself evolving? We might say his own fit mental and physical body according to the needs and pace of the human evolution, and so appearing from age to age, yuge, in some such spirit. Some would interpret the 10 incarnations of Vishnu, first in animal forms, then in the animal man, then in the dwarf man's soul, Vamana, the violent Asuric man, Rama of the X, the divinely natured man, a greater Rama, the awakened spiritual man, Buddha, and preceding him in time, but final in place, the complete divine manhood, Krishna, for the last avatar, Kalki, only accomplishes the work Krishna began. He fulfills in power the great struggle which the previous avatars prepared in all its potentialities. It is a difficult assumption to our modern mentality, but the language of the Gita seems to demand it. Or, since the Gita does not expressly solve the problem, we may solve it in some other way of our own, as that the body is prepared by the jiva, but assumed from birth by the Godhead, or that it is prepared by one of the four manos, chatvaro manavaha, chatvaro manavaha of the Gita, the spiritual fathers of every human mind and body. This is going far into the mystic field from which the modern reason is still averse. But once we admit avatarhood, we have already entered into it, and once entered, may as well treat it with firm footsteps. Shyamalu writes in Record of Yuga, we shall see how the thought of God works itself out in life. The material world is first formed with the sun as center, the sun being itself only a subordinate star of the great Agni, Mahavishnu, in whom is centered Bhu. Mahavishnu is the Virata Purusha, who, as Agni, pours himself out into the forms of sun and star. He is Agni Tvashta, Vishwakarman. He is also Prajapati and Matrishman. These are the three primal Purushas of the earth life: Agni Tvashta, Prajapati, Matrishman. All of them soul bodies of Mahavishnu. Agni Tvashta, having made the sun out of the apasa or waters of being, Prajapati, as Surya Savitra, enters into the sun and takes possession of it. He multiplies himself in the Suris or solar gods, who are the souls of the flames of Surya, the Purushas of the female solar energies. Then he creates out of this very solar body of Vishnu the planets, each of which successively becomes the bhumi or place of manifestation of for Manu, manifestation for Mano, the mental being, who is the nodus of manifest life existence and the link between the life and the spirit. The present earth, in its turn, appears as a scene of life, Mars being its last theater. In the second, finally, Prajapati appears in the form of the four manos, chatvaro manavaha. Prajapati appears in the form of four manos, chatvaro manava, not in the physical world at first, but in the mental world, which stands behind the earth life. For earth has seven planes of being, the material of which the scenes and events are alone normally visible to the material senses, the vital of which, man's pranakosha, is built, and to which it is responsive, the mental of which his manakosha is attached, the ideal governing vijnanakosha, the beatific which supports the anandakosha, and the dynamic and essential to which he has not yet developed corresponding koshas, but only unformed nimbuses of concrete being. All the gods throw out their linga rupas into these worlds of earth and to them carry on her affairs. For the lingas repeat there in the proper terms of life upon earth the conscious movements of the gods in their higher existences in the worlds above whom the manos manifested in the manoloka of Bhu bring pressure to bear upon the earth for the manifestation of life and mind. Prajapati as Rudra then begins to form life upon earth, first in vegetable, then in animal forms. Man already exists but as a god or demigod in Bhuvana Loka of Bhu, not as a man upon earth. There he is Deva, Asura, Rakshasa, Pramatha, Pishacha, Pashu, or as Deva, he is there. Or as Deva, he is either Gandharva, Yaksha, Vidyadhara, or any of the Karma Devas. For man is the son of the Mano and is assigned his place in Diva and Pradiva, in heaven and in Swarga movies. Thence he descends to earth and thither from earth he returns. All that will be explained afterwards. When the human body is ready, then he descends upon earth and occupies it. He is not a native of earth, nor does he evolve out of the animal. His manifestation in animal form is always a partial incarnation, as will be seen hereafter. On earth, Mano incarnates 14 times in each kalpa, and each of these 14 incarnations is called a Mano. These 14 Manos govern human destinies during the 100 Chaturyugas of the Pratikalpa, each in turn taking charge of a particular stage of the human advance. While that stage lasts, he directs it both from the mental world and by repeated incarnations upon earth. When Mano Prajapati wishes to incarnate in a fresh form, he has a mental body prepared for him by evolution of births, by a human vibhuti, suratha or another, and takes possession of it at the beginning of his manvantara. Each manvantara is composed of a varying number of chaturyugas according to the importance and difficulty of the stage with which it is concerned. Once, at least, in each chaturyuga, the mano or the manvantara incarnates as a man upon earth. But this never happens in the Kali Yuga. The seventh and eighth Manos are the most important in each Pratikalpa and have the longest range for their Manvantaras. The critical change is finally made from the type which was completed in the last Pratikalpa to the type which is to be perfected in the present Kalpa. For each of the 10 Pratikalpas has its type. Man in the 10 pratikalpas, progresses through the 10 types which have been fixed for this evolution in the kalpas. In this kalpa, the types, dashagu, are the 10 forms of consciousness, 10 forms of consciousness called the Pashu, Vanara, Pishacha, Pramatha, Rakshasa, Asura, Deva, Sadhyadeva, Siddhadeva, and the Satyadeva. The last three are known by other names which need not be written at present. The Pashu is mind concentrated entirely on the Annam. The Vanara mind concentrated on the Prana. The Pishacha mind concentrated on the senses and the knowledge part of the Chitta. The Pramatha mind concentrated on the heart and the emotional and aesthetic part of the Chitta. The Rakshasa mind is concentrated on the thinking Manasa, proper and taking up all the other into Manasa itself. The Asura is the mind concentrated on the Buddhi, and in the Asura, Rakshasa making it serve the Manasa and Chitta. The Deva is mind concentrated in Vijnanam, exceeding itself, but in the Asura Deva or Devasura, it makes the Vijnana serve the Buddhi. The others raise mind successively to the Ananda, Tapasa, Sat, and are respectively the Supreme Rakshasa, the Supreme Asura, the Supreme Deva. We are here, the complete scale by which mind ascends its own ladder from matter to pure being, evolved by man in the various types of which 10 principles is in the truth capable. To take the joy of these various types in the multiple play is the object of the Supreme Purusha in the human lila. God manifests himself as the four prajapatis or manos. The Chatvaro Manavaha of the Gita, and each man is born in the Ansha of the four, the first characterized by wisdom and largeness, the second by heroism and force, the third by dexterity and enjoyment, the fourth by work and service. The perfected man develops in himself all four capacities and contains at once the God of wisdom and largeness, the God of heroism and force, the God of skill and enjoyment, the God of work and service. Only one stands dominant and leads and uses the others. In response to some letters, Shivanandu answers in his letters of yoga, A time comes when Kali begins to transcend the ordinary human limits and becomes no longer the Shakti of a man, but the Shakti of God in man. It is then that gradual processes are replaced by concentrated processes. Lastly, when the man himself becomes God, either in a part of his action or in the whole, then the law of concentrated processes gives place to the involved processes. When no process at all seems to be used, when the result follow the action instantaneously, inevitably, and miraculously. In reality, there is no miracle. The process is used, but so rapidly, with such a sovereign ease, that all the stages become involved or hidden in what seems a moment's action. To most men, it is enough if they can reach the second stage. It is only the avatar or the great vibhuti who can reach the third. In this context, let us read what the mother says. She says, this is the description of one through whom Savitri was born. He is not purely human, but has his origin higher, far higher, far greater, and whose existence is much longer than the existence of the earth. He comes upon earth. He comes and reveals and is the incarnation of a divine truth. She also speaks of avatar as a supreme manifested on earth in a body. The avatar, the supreme divine manifested in an earthly form, generally a human form, for a definite purpose. Avatarhood has any meaning only if it is part of the world arrangement that he should take upon himself the burden of humanity and open the way. The descending power, avatar, chooses its own place, body, time for the manifestation. Sri Aurobindo explains, the avatar is necessary with a special work to be done, and it is a special manifestation, while for the rest of the time it is the divine working within the ordinary human limits as a vibhuti. Krishna speaks of many lives in the past, not only a few supreme ones, and secondly, that while he speaks of himself as a divine in one passage, he describes himself as a vibhuti. We may therefore fairly assume that in many lives he manifested as a vibhuti, wearing the fuller divine consciousness. An avatar is one who is conscious of the presence and power of the divine born in him or descended into him. He feels identified inwardly with this divine power and presence. What does the avatar do during his previous life? Carrying on the evolution. There are special descents to carry on the evolution to a further stage. So also, something of the divine is always there to help through each stage itself in one direction or another. The avatar is necessary when a special work is to be done, and in crisis of the evolution, the avatar is a special manifestation, while for the rest of the time, it is the divine working within the ordinary human limits as a vibhuti. Such is the glory and mystery of appearance of Ashwapati. Such is the glory and mystery of appearance of Ashwapati. Ashwapati in this mortal creation. Ashwapati, the emanation straight from the Supreme.